their people.
Work together.
In partnerships of all kinds.
To make these goals a reality for everyone, everywhere.
These are the United Nations global goals
for sustainable development.
Let's get to work.
Let's make it happen.
Hello, good morning, everybody. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Please, can you hear me? I hope I'm not muted. Yes, good morning. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Esteemed participant of SDG AP Cohort 5, the leadership of SDSN, and also our important facilitators. Thank you for joining us this morning. Last week, we spoke about our project management, and you agree with me that it was a one-of-a-kind session that we had with our facilitator, as it was able to dissect every single important that we need to know about project management. So today, I welcome you to the SDG-AP Masterclass on Leadership, Development, and Governance. Today marks a pivotal moment as we gather to delve into crucial topics that are going to be fundamental to shaping a sustainable future for us all. You know, at the helm of this transformative journey, we have the privilege of being guided by one of an exceptional facilitator who embodies the very essence of effective leadership and governance with a wealth of experience and expertise in our field. Welcome with me as I introduce to you Catherine Bosari. But before she comes on board, let me quickly give you a profile. Catherine Bosari is a transformative youth development professional, passionate about tackling youth issues, especially around access to leadership, ethics, social entrepreneurship, and participation. She has technically supported young changemakers across Africa in building sustainable social initiatives and enterprises, expanding access to sector-specific education and enterprise financing. She brings 7 years of experience in positive youth development project design, management, and implementation, the strategic planning and articulation, stakeholder management, curriculum and skill development. And she is currently functioning as the Senior Programs Coordinator at Leap Africa. It is such a great honor and a pleasure to have you join us, Madam Catherine Bosari. Please kindly share your screen, unmute your microphone, and let us see your face as you take over from here, ma'am.
Thank you, Janet. Hope you can hear me.
Yes.
All right. Give me some time to clear my screen, and then we'll get into it. I'm struggling to see people on the call. Not sure if that's just because we're streaming live from Zoom. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you and I can see your screen now.
Perfect. All right. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Thank you for joining.
It is good to be here today. My name is Catherine Bosari, as Janet has shared. And one thing about me is that I'm passionate about young people, their rights, their wrongs, just anything that has to do with young people, really, because I do believe that we're Africa's greatest assets or Africa's greatest resource. And I do think that for us to be that demographic dividend that then changes Africa, transforms Africa, we have to be properly equipped and ready to take on the new responsibility of being Africa's change agents. And so I work with Leap Africa, which is a 22-year strong organization. Yes, I said 22 years. That is simply committed to raising leaders and transforming Africa We are aware that there's a leadership gap in Africa. We're also aware that young people are primarily positioned to change the situation of things in Africa. And so we do everything that we can through five different focus areas that we believe that young people are currently struggling to transition effectively. And these areas are around education, entrepreneurship, active citizenship, good health and well-being, and employability. And so through the work that we do, we have numerous programs and projects that seek to really first change mindsets of young people, help them to understand the opportunities out there, find respectable work, and also pursue careers that will solve some of the social issues that we have in Nigeria and across Africa. And so very excited to be here today, very big SDGs advocate, especially because at LEAP Africa, we have a program just dedicated to implementing the Sustainable Development Goals. It's a youth-led campaign, and I'll be sharing more about us as we go through the slides. So today I'm here to speak to you about leadership development and governance, but I did tweak that a little bit to focus on transformative leadership, which is something that at LEAP Africa we're very passionate about. At LEAP Africa, we believe that true leadership starts with self. That means for you to be that leader that transforms communities, transforms organizations, supports young people, you have to first be a good leader of self. And a good leader of self regulates their emotions, they're kind to people, they understand who they are, they're very aware before they get on to leading others. But today we're going to move away from self-leadership and focus on how to transform communities, societies, teams, wherever it is that you find yourself. I'm not sure that I can get a sense of people in the room right now. Janet, maybe you guide me on that, but I do want us to do a quick activity. Let me know how I can get to engage people in the audience. Can you hear me? Hi, Janet, can you hear me? Struggling.
I can hear you.
All right, so I said I have an activity for people joining. So I'm struggling to understand how, you're joining on YouTube, I see you. That wasn't shared with me. So I had planned for a more engaging activity. Is there someone from the YouTube audience that can read certain answers or responses that we get?
Okay, so I am joining from Zoom as well, but we'll get information from YouTube across to you.
All right,
because all participants are joining from YouTube.
All right, so that'll be
so we can share their response with you here.
All right, that would have been a good thing to share from the start, please, because I designed this to be a very interactive session, and so you'd have to help me. All right,
okay,
so
my
first question to whoever is joining, wherever you are on YouTube, who is a leader? Who is a leader? Who is a leader? And I'll go with this. Few questions. The first is, what does leadership mean to you? What does leadership mean to you? Do you have answers on YouTube now? What does leadership mean to you? Okay, the SN handler. Are you seeing any responses? Are there certain things to pay attention to? What does leadership mean to you? Or can you share a YouTube link with me so I have two screens where I can see myself and this makes it a lot easier?
Okay.
Thank you, Glory John. A leader is a person that leads. Okay. Waiting for more responses. I'm happy to have the YouTube link also shared with me directly so that I see what's going on there and I can follow through. Okay, a leader is someone who knows the way to direct his people. Thank you. Thank you. Just saw the YouTube streaming link. Thank you. Still waiting on your comments while I try to join YouTube. Okay. waiting on more comments if you have any. A leader is someone that directs people, a leader is a person that leads. Those are all I see here. Do you have any other things to share? Not seen anything in the chat yet. All right, just checking to see if you're still with me. Can you still see my slides?
Yes.
All right, are there any other comments from you two?
No comments for now.
All right, perfect. How many people are joining from YouTube? You want to share that number with me?
Sorry, give me a minute, please.
I can't hear you. I know that you said something, Royce. I can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you perfectly. I said, how many people are joining us from YouTube? Just so I understand the kind of response.
Sorry, let me get you the number.
Thank you. That we'll be getting, because it just seemed like people are a bit quiet. All right, going on to the next question. List five people that you regard as leaders. List five people that you regard as leaders. Anything from YouTube, anything from the handler, this would be a good time to share. Thank you, but I can't off my screen and look at YouTube. I've tried that already. It will take me away from my slides, unless you can share the link with me via email. It would have been nice to be prepared for a YouTube link. Thank you. So any responses from the YouTube link, just to see?
Okay, someone is trying to share the YouTube link to you via your email, and I'm also trying to open my YouTube via my laptop as well.
So, all right, I was just asking to see if their response is. I can't open on my laptop, so that's why the email would be preferred.
I'll check that for you. You can just continue, I'll check that for you.
Thank you. So it's an interactive session, and I need the interaction to go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. If you do not mind sharing that link again.
So we have this person said, we have a lot of comments from Joy Ogunru. It says, I regard teachers, pastors, presidents, parents, local government chairman as leaders. Chukwuchina Gurum also said,
can you hear me?
I think there's some interference in your background, but I can see YouTube now. Thank you very much, everyone, for responding. I feel like I'm in a class with people now. So yes, I see leadership is like a roadmap. Leadership is about teamwork, collaborative effort between leaders and followers. A leader is someone that takes ownership of his people, community, organization to make things right. I see, yes, Amos, I wasn't seeing your responses, but I can see it now. A leader is someone that takes ownership of his people, community, organization to make things right. I see a leader is someone that has foresight to carry other people along on a journey that impacts you and them. I see a leader is someone that serves. I also see people answering the second question, seeing Mahatma Gandhi, Tony Elumelu. I see... Miles Monroe, Barack Obama, John Obidi, Sam Adeyemi. Thank you, that person, for giving us a very extensive list. I see religious leaders, some people say pastors. Someone says, someone that is their influences, that teaches, that educates, is a leader to them. I see John Maxwell, just looking through very quickly to see names that I haven't seen before. Okay, I see Chimamanda, that's a woman coming in here. I see Jesus Christ, I see Martin Luther King, I see Chinua Achebe, I see, looking through very quickly to see what we're sharing. I see a lot of us sharing. I'm very happy about that, by the way. A lot of people have shared, you know, names of presidents, governors. People have mentioned even old leaders like Ken Sarowiwa. I see someone saying they can barely hear, so I'm not sure if that's something from admin's end. Please let us know if you can still hear me in the chats. Thank you for sharing. The final question, why do you consider these people that you mentioned leaders? Why do you consider them leaders? What is that one thing about them that strikes you as leadership? Thank you. I see Dora Quinley, another woman. It's quite interesting that we don't have that many women on this list, just two I've seen so far. Okay. I see someone says their mother. Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, all right, thank you. So the final question, why do you consider these people leaders? Why do you consider them leaders? What is that one thing about them so that helps you consider them as leaders? They sacrifice their lives. Thank you, Yusuf Yao. Anyone else? They sacrifice their comfort for the well-being of others. Thank you, Abdul. Selflessness. Thank you, Eze. Salima says, the way they impact and add value to people's lives. Mamza, I hope I'm saying that right, please pardon me. The way they nurture their community. I've seen another volume, please. So not sure if that's just people in the studio can hear me properly. I see people that say they can also hear me properly, just to be sure. I see people saying they
can hear you properly.
Perfect. I see people saying leaders sacrifice their lives, peoples and cultures. They serve others. They take responsibility. They show you the right things to do for it to be effective. Their ability to impact lives and add values. They have influence. Some people have said that. Someone said because of their foresight and ability to inspire people. Thank you. Keep it coming. Someone says they hold leadership positions. That's interesting. We'll talk about that later. Their level of tolerance, their pace setters. Okay, thank you very much. I want us to watch a video very quickly. So I'll just share my screen and show us a video very quickly. Please let me know if you can hear the sound once I start playing. Just to share that even if you can't hear the sound, it's not that kind of video. Just pay attention to what's going on and not the sound. So let me pause for a little while and ask, could you see the video playing? Janet or anyone in the studio, please help me. Let me know if you can see the video. Yes, you can. Thank you. So you don't need to hear the audio. The video really just speaks to, is trying to tell you a story. So you don't need to see what the video is saying. Just focus on the actions in the video. All right, perfect. Can you still hear me? Can you still hear me? Just going to go back to our YouTube link to see. I see, yes. The video doesn't have an audio, don't worry. Just pay attention to the actions, and I hope that you did. So let's talk about the video that we just watched. And I see your comments, very appreciative of the 216 people that have joined and are sharing what they think, answering old questions. I like that. Let's talk about the video. What did you notice about the video? What is that one thing that you noticed about the video? I see interesting video, okay. The little boy is an inspiration for growth, okay. What else are you noticing about the video? The little boy embodies the change begins with me mantra. Oh, I like that. Thank you, John. Oluwaseyi for me, good that you can hear me clearly now. Oyewale says, they're role models. Yusuf says, the boy is doing well to serve. Mr. T says, this is the quality and capacity of good leadership. Bright says, there's joy from every hand that's on the work, you know, in the video. I'm seeing people say, oh, the boy led by example. That's from Abubakar Ibrahim. Grace says, I see selfless service. Niger Zone says, I see responsible citizens. That's a good one. Monday says, the boy changed the mindset that, you know, leaders can do things together. Annie Amos says, the little boy demonstrated leadership by drawing the attention of others on how to solve a problem. People notice leadership skills. Someone says, I notice courage. Thank you, John Jacob Emmanuel. Courage, that's a very, very important one. Someone says that they see the kid as a potential leader. Potential. Why not a leader? Okay. What characters have you noticed or did you notice in the video? What characters did you notice? Anyone? I see someone saying they noticed the policeman. Okay. What other character did you notice? Like, what other people in the videos did you notice? The specific different people. You know, think about it as a movie. What are the people that you noticed? Of course, you noticed the boy. Who else noticed anything? Someone noticed the policeman. Someone noticed that the police that should have done the work did not do it. In fact, one of them was sleeping, if you agree with me. Someone said they saw collaboration with people. Thank you. A lot of us noticed the policemen, yes. You know, you would think they're supposed to be leaders, but they're there, not doing what's required. Did anyone notice anybody that seemed like an important person that he carried over the tree? You notice the woman that told, I'm not sure if it was her brother or her friend, to go and join them. I see that. Did anyone notice the pedestrians? You notice the politician. Yes, you did. That politician that he had to carry over the tree. Did you notice that? Someone said they also noticed the logo because that was the main character in the story. Thank you. Someone says they saw civil servants, the public, those on the bus, pedestrians, people standing around. Thank you. I'll take one more. Someone said they saw other kids like him. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And you're all right. And you're all really right. And I see a lot of us are even answering the same questions. The politicians, the police that we all thought would be leaders in that scenario were not the people that we thought they were going to be. It took just one young boy on his way to school because, you know, he was in his uniform with his school bag. It took just one young boy to say, you know what, this has to change. And I'm sure when he left the house that morning, he was probably the last born of his family or the smallest child in the house. And he wasn't really just the person that we thought he was going to be. We thought he was going to be the politician, you know, helping people over the tree. We thought he was going to be, maybe the older man in there. One particular thing that I noticed in this video is the fact that we noticed that change starts with the youngest people in the room. Who noticed that? It was the young boy, then small young boys just like himself, before older people started to join in. And you saw the progression. Even older people had different stages and different ages that joined him to push the tree. Did anybody see that? People that were watching, you know, seeing those young boys were immediately humbled. They were immediately humbled and they had to go out and just join. Did anybody see that? you saw people sitting on the fence and wondering, you know, should I go, should I not go? But the young children did not even think about it. All they saw was their fellow young person or small boy, and they immediately went to join him. You know, it might have seemed like it was fun, but they knew that he had something to accomplish. So they joined him, and then immediately they supported that effort that he was trying to make. Little kids, it started with little kids, then it moved all the way to the older people. I really liked that progression. I really liked that progression. And I think that I see a lot of people saying in the chat, you know, what this represents to them. Someone said, it means that change begins with me. Someone said the oldest people were the ones to join. Someone said, no one is too small to help. Someone said, I see the leadership spirit. Let me look through very quickly again to see what other people are saying. Someone said, I think selflessness is just the character that was here. No one is so small to lead. I've seen that over and over again. And that's true. No one is so small to lead. And in that particular position, you could see that even though he was just a schoolboy on his way to school, he was a leader. And I know that when I asked you earlier, you know, share some leaders with me, a lot of people said, oh, this politician, that governor, that man, that woman, you know, people that seem to be in positions of power. But there's certain things I would like to demystify at Leap Africa about leadership. And I'll just take you through them very quickly. For us at Leap Africa, anyone can be a leader. You're the smallest person in the room, the biggest, the skinniest, the strongest. Anyone can be a leader. For us, leaders are not born. They're not in positions. It's just an act. It's one person deciding this can't go on anymore and saying, I want to change this. So for us at Leap Africa, anyone can be a leader. You don't have to be born into leadership. And I'm sure some of us are wondering, you know, are people really born into leadership? If you think back to the fact that, okay, let me use the British monarchy as an example. They are born into leadership. You know, if you're born as a prince and, you know, your father is king, you have to step into that position. So you're born into that. But one thing people don't realize is even if you're born into leadership, born into royalty, or you are royalty, leaders still have to go through a process of being defined, refined, honed, their skills honed, to really turn into those leaders. And so we understand that even though people have opportunities or they have the privilege to be born into leadership positions, leadership is an act and it's something that you choose to do. So when things are going wrong, when things seem challenging, that person that stands up and says, you know what, everyone else sees challenges, I see possibilities as a leader. And so you can see very quickly that taking us through the first three perspectives, anyone can be a leader. You know, if you're there thinking, oh, that boy, you know, just helped, he wasn't really a leader. No, that's not true. He was a leader in that scenario. He is a leader and he's someone that would regard as a leader. He wasn't born to be a leader. In fact, he didn't wake up that morning deciding to be a leader, but he saw an opportunity. He saw a challenge. Where others saw a challenge, sorry, he saw a possibility. So leaders are not made, are not born, they're made. Leadership is an act, it's not a position. You don't have to be a doctor or a lawyer or the head leader or the class monitor or the manager of a team to be a leader. It's just about taking that one chance. There's also leadership, you know, seeing opportunities where others see challenges. Another perspective that we have at Leap Africa about leadership is that anyone can lead in different ways. So if I decide to come into work today, there's been an issue, for example, say I noticed that a lot of my female staff are going on maternity leave, and you know, when they're coming back as mothers, you know, they're struggling to go back into the world of work. If I say we need to change our gender policy, we need to make the workplace even more friendly to women, that's leadership. If I see a tree on my way to school like that boy did, and I'm stepping in to say I'm going to push this tree no matter who helps me, that's a leader. If I choose today that I don't want to see children out of school on the streets and I want to start an initiative to help children with after school programs, that's a leader. As long as you're contributing to positive change, you can lead in any way. One thing about us is that we believe that effective leadership is about making positive changes. And if you agree with me, I know people were saying, a lot of people in the chat were saying they saw some gang leaders in the video. You can make a change that's not positive, or you can be a leader and what you're doing is not positive. That's actually so true. you can lead a group of people, have 30 billion people following you, 100 people following you, calling you the capor, the captain, the king, and you could be bringing about negative change. For us, you're not a leader. A leader has to make positive change that impacts the lives of others. One other thing that we believe is what you've also said in the chats. You saw a lot of teamwork in that video. And so at Leap Africa, we believe that leaders do not do all the work by themselves. They share their vision with other people and convince them to join them in the quest for positive change. And so you saw that young boy stepping up. You know, you can see that this young boy in many ways is a perspective of an amazing leader. So he saw that that tree was huge, but that didn't stop him. He had a vision and he knew that if I could just start it, I would get help and this tree would move. He knew that was possible. And so he took the first leap. So leaders are not afraid to take risks. They see the vision and they go for it. And that's who we regard as a leader. And just as we were speaking about before, moving on to the next slide, leaders are those that have a clear vision. Nothing deters them. They don't think, oh, it's not possible for me to do this thing, or this thing looks like a mountain. I can't move it, you know. Immediately, he knew that it was possible for him to move that tree. He went right ahead. And I'm sure that he knew that he could not do it by himself, but it was clear what he was trying to achieve in mind. What he was trying to achieve was very clear to him. And so what he did was he went there, he had a vision, and other people joined him, and that vision came true. So leaders are very clear on what they're trying to achieve. The boy didn't go to the tree and decide to sit on it. No. He went to push it because he knew that he wanted to get that out of the way. He was very clear with what he wanted to do. He had an objective to push that. He had a goal to ask people, to help people see what's possible, where that tree was concerned. And so that happened. 8, leaders earn respect. They don't demand it by shouting or by screaming. A true leader is the person that steps into a room and everybody gravitates towards. You saw right after the tree got pushed, people came, you know, played with his head, you know, gave him a high five, people were happy. That's how leaders command respect. They don't have to shout and say, I am a leader, before they get the attention. No, they get that respect because they've shown that they're vulnerable, they're human, they can see what's possible, and then people come with them on their journey and their quest for positive change. 9 perspective about leadership that we have at Leap Africa, which I already mentioned before, is that leaders are all about taking risks. You know, something can be so frightening, so disorienting. They can be so afraid of something, but they will still go ahead and do it. You know, a leader would go into a community that's underserved or a community that is violent and not say, oh, people that are working for me should go ahead and I'll come join that. No, the leader goes in there, starts the relationship, sets the tone, and others will come in and take on your initiative. You know, so you have to be a risk taker to be a leader. And finally, you know, if you remember from the very beginning when I started this session, I said, we believe that leadership starts from self. Leadership starts from self. If you had someone that was asking you to do a thing and you know for a fact that you haven't done it before, or you know for a fact that they're scared, I'm sure you wouldn't join them. Or will you? Please let me know. So a leader is someone that understands themselves. They know what their triggers are, the things that make them upset, the things that make them fight, the things that make them act out of character. They know what that is and they can keep it in check. A leader is someone that's not afraid to say, oh, I'm having a difficulty. What do you think about this? How can we work around this? A leader is aware that they need to be accountable to others. Thank you, Ahmad. Ahmad is saying leadership has to do with people's interests. You have to be interested in people, what people are trying to do. A leader has the ability to listen, and I mean really listen. A lot of people, when people are speaking to you, you're looking at them, but you can't hear them. And so when they say, did you hear what I said? And they say, oh, can you repeat what I said? And you're scratching your head and saying, oh my God, actually I wasn't listening. But a true leader is an active listener. They're listening to you, they're asking questions, they're confirming what you have said, you know, trying to understand what you have said. And then a true leader has compassion. And just running through all the perspectives of leadership. And so if you're wondering, am I really a leader? Just remember that leaders choose to be leaders. They're made and born. Leadership is not an act, it's not a position. You don't have to be a governor, the biggest person, the strongest person to be a leader. Leadership is about seeing possibilities where others see problems, where others see challenges. And you can lead in different ways. The sky is your limit with leadership. It could be in your small classrooms if you're still in school. It could be in your workplace. It could be at home. It could be in your community. As long as you're creating positive changes in your society, you are a leader. Remember, leaders do not do all the work by themselves. They carry people in their quest for positive change. They work with people. They're not afraid to share their vulnerabilities, their plans with people. Leaders also have very clear visions, clear goals. Leaders are not coming and asking you to join them to do an initiative, possibly to educate out-of-school children, and they're telling you, so maybe we'll go today, maybe we don't go tomorrow. They're very clear what they're trying to achieve. They know what they want to see at the end of that training. So they're telling you what's expected, and you feel comfortable following them or working with them. Effective leaders are not, you know, demanding, or they don't demand, they don't order you around. They earn respect. In fact, the best leaders are articulate. You know, they're gentle. They speak to you and say, "Ah, I thought this was going to work, but it didn't work. But I learned this," you know. The best leaders are those that can control themselves, you understand? The best leaders are also those that can take, oh, I see Mercy saying the volume is getting low. Can you still hear me, Mercy? Let me know. The best leaders are those that can take risks. The ones that will go ahead of others, you know, and not say, oh, this community is violent. Let me send people that work with me there and then I'll come join them when things are calm. I'm seeing the volume, please, the volume, please. Please confirm from the studio. Can you still hear me clearly?
Of course we can. We can hear you, but please go ahead.
All right, perfect. I'm seeing some things in the chat. All right, then. Leaders are also first. True leaders are first leaders of self. They know who they are. They are accountable. They are aware of their strengths, their weaknesses. They listen, and they listen really good. They listen actively. They have compassion for others. All right, those are the 10 perspectives of leadership that we have at Lead Africa. So I'm very mindful of the time, so I'll just go through till we get to a point where I want us to speak about leadership styles. So I want us to prioritize specific things. And I guess my question to you is, when you're engaging people, how do you engage others? Does anyone want to share? If you have to work in a team, what is that one thing or two or three things that you do? If you have to engage people, what are those things that you do? Thank you. So I'm seeing different things in the comments. I'm seeing we can't hear you. I'm seeing we can hear you clearly. I'm seeing we cannot hear you. But that's fine. This will be on YouTube for you to rewatch, I'm sure. All right. So how do you engage others? Who wants to share with me in the chats? How do you engage others? What kind of leader are you? What type of leader are you? Does anyone want to share with me in the chats? What type of leader are you? Are you a leader that communicates? Are you a leader that's, you know, when you're speaking to people, you try to give them incentives or say, if you do this thing for me, I'll buy you something? What type of leader are you? You know, if you've tried to lead teams. Thank you, Damilola. Damilola says, I try to communicate effectively. Someone says, when I'm engaging, the vision has to be very clear, clearly shared and understood. Someone says I communicate effectively. Someone says I'm empathic. Oh, Mr. Consequence, thank you for this. He says I manage the group based on their strengths. I see Omar saying I engage them by making decisions. Okay, please clarify that. John says I get to know their strengths and weaknesses. Mr. Didi Boy says I impact their skills and help them, you know, with their knowledge, experience. Sheyifumi says, I ask for their opinions. Thank you, Sheyifumi. And assess their opinions, their suggestions. Ebenezer says, I find what is common between all of us and what we want to achieve. Okay, thank you. And you've taken me very quickly into leadership styles. Leadership styles. If you're a visionary, you're saying, come with me. This is my plan. I think it was Naz that said, be clear with your vision and carry others along. Doris also said, the vision has to first be clear. So visionary leaders are those saying, come with me, let's work together. They're not saying, come with me now, this is why I want to come with me, you know, just believe me, follow me. No, they're saying, come with me on this journey. They're also coaches that say, I see what you're doing, but how about you try this? there are democratic leaders that are always asking for your opinions. And I see someone that said that earlier to say, I always ask for opinions. John said, know their strengths and weaknesses. Someone says, I draft their roles. Okay, that's Monday. I allocate roles to everyone. Pressure says, I do a lot of talking, inspiring others with my vision. And Ahmed just put the icing on the cake. I can't say your surname, Ahmed, but Ahmed M, just so I don't mispronounce that. He says, I always ask open-ended questions that can make people talk about their opinions through my communications. And you know what? That's perfect. Open-ended questions. What do you think? You're not leading them to give an answer that you want them to give you. You're asking very openly, oh, we're trying to do this. What do you think? We want to go into this community. What do you think? I was thinking we could do this. What do you think? And then we have the leaders that nobody likes. The ones that say, you have to do what I tell you. Even if it's not clear, you have to do exactly what I tell you. You know, those are commanding, authoritative leaders. And then we have affiliative leaders, the ones that people come first to. And I know that someone shared that earlier. The person said, I need to understand people's strengths for complete process optimization. Someone said, I need to understand what people are interested in. I need to make everyone, thank you, James Princewell. I need to make everyone understand that they're important in the team. And James Princewell has hit that on the head. He says, people come first to me. I need to let them know that they're important. I need to work with them. And I'm trying to share very quickly the 6 leadership styles by Daniel Goleman. And this is something that, you know, aligns with the first one I shared with you. It just speaking to different kinds of leaders and different kinds of situations and how leaders act, or the styles of leadership that people employ in different scenarios. And the first one is commanding. That's the one that's I shared earlier, the ones that are saying, you must do what I tell you, even when you're not clear. You know, they're very authoritative. They feel like they need to shout. And these are people that they're very focused on, you know, you achieving what they need. They're very focused on just you turning things around as soon as they want it. And most times they are, you know, very, what's the word? They demand immediate compliance. They want you to answer them immediately. Okay, we'll come to that. They're visionary leaders, the ones that say, oh, listen to me, come with me. This is what I have for you. This is what I think that the world can be. This is what I think could happen if we enter into that that's community. You know, they're very big on self-leadership or self-confidence, some empathy. They're big on creating change. They're also affiliative ones. You know, they're big on building relationships, you know, communication. Like a few of us have said, like John Yakubu says, I'm big on listening to people's views. They're democratic leaders. They're big on team leadership, communication, collaboration. Like someone said, they want everyone to feel important. Like someone has shared earlier on the team, they want people to feel very important. And they're also pace setters. Pace setters are saying, you know, watch me. I know someone said that earlier. He said, let me do it and you watch, you know, just so you understand. But that's a pace setting kind of leadership. For them, they're focusing on leading by example, yes, but they're also focusing on leading on high performance. Okay. They're saying, watch me, see how I'm doing this now and do it after me. You see? And they're also leaders that are coaches, the ones that are saying, try this. They're not going to micromanage you. They're not going to force your hand. They're going to say, this is how I want to do this. So how about you do this and try your hand at this? You see? So maybe I just pause here and ask you, what is the best kind of leadership? I want to see in the chats. Out of all of these 6, commanding, visionary, affiliative, democratic, pace setting, and coaching, what do you think is the best style of leadership? Anyone? So visionary is, you know, do what I tell you. Sorry, commanding, pardon me, is do what I tell you. Visionary is come with me. Affiliative is I want to understand, you know, people come first, people are important to me. Democratic is what do you think about this thing? Pace setting is do as I do now. Coaching is how about you try this? Okay, thank you, Shayupumi. Shayupumi says visionary. Out of the 6 people, visionary. I see visionary again. Okay, I see visionary again. Thank you, Timothy, Mubarak, Victory, Thank you, Sheyifumi. Thank you, Ibrahim. I see visionary again. Thank you. I'm seeing people now saying more. Mr. Didi Boy says democratic. Ogochukwu says democratic. Oyekachi says visionary. Okay. Abdul Aziz says affiliative. Okay. I see more visionary. Okay. A new one. Israel says coaching. Kennedy says pace setter. All right. I see more visionary. Visionary. Okay. Moses and Frank and John say coaching. Okay. And there's someone that's trying to say, you know what? I think a proper blend of all is best. Okay. I see more. I see more visionary coaching, democratic. Okay, I see some, you know, A1 students saying there's no best single style. It's better for you to employ up to 2 to 3 styles. I see Joy saying coaching, visionary, democratic. Bright says, I think it is situational. Bright, you've taken us to the next part of the session. It is situational. Bright is very right. It is situational. Sometimes you need to be that leader that coaches. You know, if you maybe possibly have a low performing team and you want to increase their performance, that is an opportunity for you to be a coach, for you to adopt the coaching style, to say, okay, everyone, I want you to do this, go ahead and do it. You know, it's okay to make mistakes. That's a good time to be a coach. For pace setting, sometimes, if you agree with me, there's sometimes that you have very strict deadlines and you just want high performance on the team. And if you have a very high performing team, you can do pace setting, because pace setting is, you know, setting high standards for performance and people are focusing on that, you see. A democratic leader, you know, there are certain scenarios when being a democratic leader is amazing, where you want people to, you know, share inputs, you want to get buy-in, you want people to follow you. You know, imagine if you're running for elections now, the best leader to be when you're asking for votes is to be democratic, you know. Democratic, also visionary, but democratic in the point that you want people to rally to your side, you want to get their inputs, you know, to understand how to run your campaign. But if you're now at the point where you want them to vote for you, you can be a visionary, you know, tell them what you're trying to do, what the future looks like, what change you're going to bring. Affiliative, you know, for example, if you're working in a team and everyone is fighting, to heal that team, to motivate people during stressful scenarios, you have to be an affiliative leader. You know, you have to understand them, be empathetic, you know, build relationships, communicate. And the commanding one, you know, people say, oh my God, I don't want a commanding boss. I don't want a commanding leader. But sometimes when employees are not doing so great, you see people turn into commanding leaders. And for me personally, I do not like commanding style of leadership. I think that no matter what the situation is, you can find a balance between the other five. But commanding, you know, no matter what scenario it is, it has a negative impact on the team, you know, in the long run. And I also resonate with that, with pace setting too. Unless you have a high performing team, pace setting can also be quite negative in the long run. But the ones that we know for a fact that are always going to work in every scenario is first visionary, then affiliative, democratic, and then coaching. So you need a combination of all those, and you need to understand the situation and know when to pull out the visionary leader in you, the affiliative leader in you, or the democratic leader in you, or the coach in you. You know, you need to understand those certain scenarios and know when to pull those out. So just pause in here, because I know that the SDSN team has asked about questions. So if you have questions, this is a good time to start to ask them. I know we started a bit late, and so just checking with the SDSN team, how much time do I have? Is it still 6 minutes, or do I have an extra time based on the late start that we had? Please let me know. Hi, Jeanette. Hi. Let me see who else is in the room with me. Hi. Please let me know how much time we have. Do we wrap up at 10? Or
I sent you a message. I just sent you a message on the chat box. Just kind of check.
All right, perfect. Okay, I have 5 minutes to go. Thank you. So I think I'll take questions. We've spoken about what else is on the slide, but it'll be good to take questions at this point, if you have them. And if not, we'll just go through the raise model very quickly. Okay, so I see a question from Aliyu. He says, since a leader is a role model and mentor, why are leaders wicked nowadays and not ready to help people, and how can we change them in the right way? Thank you, Aliyu. And I can see that this is stemming from a place of you just noticing certain behaviors in people. And so maybe one thing to say is that there's always been that issue of people not being true leaders. Not everyone thinks that true leadership is serving. You know, not everyone thinks that true leadership can be coaching or being democratic and asking for opinions. And so we see a lot of people that believe that when they're leaders, when they're in the room, you're quiet or you're not speaking a lot. So the only thing you can do is just have that positive feedback with people that you can have with. So understanding what the perfect opportunity is to share your feedback with people. If you have a very confrontational leader that you're working with, maybe it's not best for you to reach out to them face to face and share a conversation. Maybe an anonymous note can do the job. A nice anonymous note to say, I see the work that you're doing, but I wish that we could talk more. You understand? I see what you're doing, but I wish that you could do this better. You know, those kind of conversations could help you. So I see someone say, why is leadership a major challenge in our country today? You know, when I started the session, I said that LEAP Africa, the L in LEAP Africa actually stands for leadership. And that's because we're very aware that there's a big leadership gap in Africa, in Nigeria as a whole. And this stems from corruption, from people setting positive and negative trends. You know, people that feel like once they're in certain positions, they have to act a certain way. But because you've learned today that leadership is not just about position, it's about actions, you know that you can separate yourself as a leader, you see? You know that if you have the opportunity to work with people, you can do more of being visionary, of being democratic, of being affiliative and supporting them. Honestly, there's going to be a lot of changes that have to happen in Nigeria and Africa as a whole, but it could start with you. I see someone say, what's the difference between leaders and rulers? I like this question very much because they're two very different things. And I think that in Nigeria or in Africa as a whole, or globally actually, we have some stories. So someone in the studio, your mic is on. We have sort of embraced the fact that for you to be a leader, you have to be confrontational, you have to be commanding, but that's not the case. So a leader is someone that is all these things I've mentioned, you know, is collaborative, has a clear vision, clear goals, objectives. You know, a leader is anyone in any scenario that chooses to create positive change. A leader is someone that communicates very clearly. A leader is someone that seeks to really communicate what they're trying to do and they're accountable for it, you see. A ruler, on the other hand, that's a dictator. That's someone that doesn't care about your opinions, care about what you do. It's just trying to enforce something on you. That's the big difference. Okay, so let me see more questions. I hope that was a good answer for you, Abdulaziz. Let me see more questions. Okay, the WhatsApp group wouldn't be for me. I'm sure the SDS team will share more details with you about that. Okay, so someone says, how do we thrive and achieve our goals under selfish leaders? This is a very fantastic question, Mercy. Under selfish leaders, you have to, it's a very hard one to navigate, honestly. One thing that we're very passionate about in LEAP Africa is change ethics and social values, helping people understand that a true leader is someone that is ethical in whatever scenario it is. You're morally ethical, you're not just situationally ethical, you see. And so when you come across leaders that are selfish, leaders that are not choosing to do things the right way, then you have to understand how to navigate them. You see, you have to understand how to navigate that situation. And like I said, when there's that problem in society where there's like issue that people just feel like, oh, as leaders, they are corrupt, they're selfish. You have to first understand how to navigate that scenario that you're in. You know, is it a kind of community or society that you can speak up or a team that you can speak up on? If not, what's the best way to approach these people, you see? You have to understand what's possible and what's not possible first. So I'm saying that if you want to change, if you want to create change, it's not by confronting what's already existing. It's by showing people what's possible, you see? If everybody on your team is choosing to act a certain way, you can start by acting differently. you can start by helping others, coaching others, encouraging others. When people start to see that you're much different, they gravitate towards you. And it's just a thing that happens. So you're walking the talk that you're saying. You're saying, oh, let's not do this, but you're also not doing it. It's a bit fancy. Okay, if this person doesn't do it, then that's fine. You can see the young boy in the video that we had. The politician walked over. The police were sleeping. But he said, you know what? Even though all of these things are happening around me, I will still do that one positive thing that sets me apart or that helps me show people that true leadership is service. True leadership is you know, taking action. And so when you're in positions where you have selfish leaders or the society is not allowing you to be who you are, just remember that you could do one thing that reminds people of what's possible. And I always go back to the boy and the tree, you know, the video that we shared earlier, the boy and the tree, to just remind you that it is possible to be different when things, you know, seem to be against you. So my time is up. I'm looking at Janet's time for me, and it is up. But I do want to say that I really enjoyed myself today. I liked that we were very, very communicative, collaborative, and we shared our thoughts in the chat. Thank you so much for having me. And I look forward to doing this more. And if you have other questions, you can follow me on LinkedIn at Catherine Busari and ask them. You know, very happy to have those questions answered. All right, over to you, Team SDSN. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Catherine, for sharing and enriching us with the leadership development and governance. It was such a fantastic class, a fantastic session with you, which we all learned a lot, most especially on the video that you shared. I'm very sure that they were able to get your LinkedIn account, and if they have any other questions, for instance, Bright Ebong says, can you get the document that you're teaching with, like, I mean, your slides, if you will be glad if you can share that with us so we can share it with all our participants. So on behalf of the leadership of SDGs in Nigeria and everyone, all the participants that are present here, I extend our heartfelt appreciation for your time, your effort, and your expertise in teaching us this. Your contribution to our masterclass here has been immensely valuable. I will look forward to applying all that you've taught us on leadership, development, and governance on our journey. Thank you so much for coming in. Thank you so much. Our next facilitator is around the corner, and he will be taking us on grant application and proposal writing. You know that we have two sessions in every of our masterclass. So the second session is going to be on grant application and proposal. And our next facilitator is ready to share with us on the topic of grant application and proposal writing. And first of Dr. Charles. I don't know if I get the pronunciation. Well, Dr. Charles, apologies, Dr. Charles. So I'll just go with Dr. Charles. So before he comes up, let me quickly share his profile with you. Dr. Charles is a business manager, is a published clinical researcher, a veterinarian, artist, entrepreneur, and LinkedIn optimization coach. He has gathered experience across networking, partnership, program execution, business operations, account, finance, recruitment, talent management, and various leadership roles. Charles is currently the head of resource mobilization at the Murtala Mohammed Foundation, where he drives fundraising efforts through programs and donor management across education, women empowerment, governance, and humanitarian response. He is also a volunteer mentor of Faith Foundation, the In-Depth Africa, FAO VPP projects, and more. Please welcome with me Dr. Charles. Thank you for coming on. Please, you can go ahead and unmute your mic and share your slide with us. I'm sure they can hear you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Your voice is a little bit shaky. I don't know, maybe.
Yeah, I'm not asking. I don't know if you could ask. Yeah. Yeah, I'm unable to share my screen. I don't know if you could help with that.
Okay. Someone will get across with you now.
Okay. Okay, while we wait to sort that out, good morning everyone. So I'll be talking to us today about grants application and proposal writing. So please, Janet, I want you to go to just let me know. So today we're talking about grants and application and proposal writing. And basically there are lots of information out there. And there are lots of information out there. And then I think it's up to me. I mean, we could go on YouTube, could go on Google, we could see lots of content out there online. But the major challenge might be to understand the context. Where do we fit in specifically? And then I think it's up to me to be able to throw more light on how we can walk around, navigate this, and also give some tips on some, some metrics for success. Why it might seem that some people apply for grants and they get it, and others have been applying for years and then nothing ends up happening. So that's what I'm going to focus on and talking to us a bit about today. And let me see if I can. Okay. And so Janet, I don't know, I might need to be made a host if possible.
Apply for grants.
Okay, so a minute, please. What do you say?
Okay, so I think while we work on that, let me just get started. Okay, I'm a host now. Okay, thank you. Let me work on that. Thank you. Okay, I'm sharing my screen now. Please let me know if you can see.
I'm sharing my screen now. Please let me know if you can see.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. And please let me confirm if the audio is okay. Okay, I'm Janet. Could you let me confirm if the audio is fine? So I can get started. Okay, please, I need someone to help me confirm if the audio is okay so I can get started, please. Okay, let me just wait a minute. I just want to be sure the audio is fine. Okay, I guess because of time, I'll just get started. So please, Janet, if you're able to come, I'm online, or just let me confirm if the audio is fine.
Your
so I can.
Just...
Yes.
We can hear you clearly.
Okay. Thank you.
And so I'm slide.
Okay, thank you very much, Janet. Thank you. So today we're talking about proposal writing. And then grant application. Let me just make do with that.
We can see your screen.
Okay. Part of what we'll cover today will be aspects of fundamentals of proposal writing. How do you write proposals? What are proposals? Another aspect to also cover what's the structure for writing proposals? What are the major things we want to look at? Another aspect to also look at the basic components of proposals, especially when applying for grants. And I think then most of what is going to be in the first aspects are generic things that we need to know. The second aspect to actually cover some tips from my experience of what I've learned in the field, especially aspects of funding. Where do you get the funding? Where do you find the funders? What kind of funders do we have? And what are some of the major expectations that they have? Then the sixth aspect to talk a bit about researching and relationship building. Believe me, you want to learn how to do your research and how to also explore relationships as well. Then the last aspect, assuming you've gotten the grant or you've gotten the funding, how do you maintain those relationships to ensure that not only are your funders happy with you, but you can also refurbish or you can also even
relationship get building.
Okay, so you can also get additional funding and I'm working on the impact report as well. I have a video here.
You're going to have an uncomfortable time with me.
Okay.
My main point here is that you've got absolutely no experience in fashion or the pre-loved market, so that makes it very, very difficult to give you credibility.
Would I be able to respond to that?
Not necessarily.
Okay. In your business plan, you do say you've designed. Actually, this was bought from a high street store, and I would say it's pretty identical.
Wow.
So let's be honest. Have you designed anything? Just give me a yes or no answer. Have you designed anything?
No.
Thank you.
I have to say, you certainly don't come across as someone I would want to work with.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Why do you say that, Claudine?
You state you're brutally honest, you don't do small talk, and mm-hmm. you can't bear people complaining. You can imagine, I'm thinking to myself, is this really how you plan to run your company?
You have no background in the supplement business and no experience in the alcohol business. Am I correct?
In terms of direct experience, I do not have it. Personally do...
Don't tell me you drink a cocktail.
No, it's not
that. Or
you
take a protein supplement.
I'm very much into my health and fitness, and I am kind of like my target consumer.
I buy clothes. It doesn't make me a dressmaker.
Absolutely.
You've opened one store and one kiosk in 5 years. Mm-hmm. Why has your growth been so pedestrian?
Look, I can see why it may look like we've had a slow route to success, but there's no reason that can't accelerate now. I can run it, I know every element of the business, and I know what I need to do to get to 100 stores.
But that's not your strategy, not in here, is it? Your strategy is to open one new store with Lord Sugar's backing every year. There's nothing in here about reaching 100 stores.
You're
making this up as you go along now.
No, Mike.
So you're going from 89,000...
Yep.
..to... 758,000.
Correct?
No, it's not correct. It's impossible.
Who says it's impossible?
I do. You can't go from 90,000 to 750,000 in one go.
Yeah, but that's... I think I can, because I did 89,000 on my own. So if I can do that on my own with not a lot of investment, with a 250,000 investment and staff and more stock, I think that is achievable.
You may think so, but I'm telling you, it's never going to happen.
I don't think there's anything wrong with being ambitious, Claude.
No, ambitious is one thing. Unrealistic is nonsense. That shows you haven't got a handle on a business. More than that, after this incredible 758,000 of turnover, what do you end up with? A loss of nearly £250,000. This is the rantings of a lunatic.
Really and truthfully, thinking, wishing,
I
hoping,
don't wish,
thinking,
I do make things happen.
Well, you haven't made it happen here to convince me. It's a pipe dream with no substance.
The one thing that really needs to muscle up is your business plan.
Yeah.
Here's one of my business plans. Can you spot the difference?
Yeah.
I am the owner and founder of my own business, etc., etc. I've done this, I've done that, I've done absolutely everything. Whereas that's not at all true. Because you've got a 50-50 partner with your sister.
I do.
So the thing that you've put forward is a lie.
And what's your website going to be called?
It's www.myeverydaypyjamas.co.uk.
Okay. So you've bought that, right?
I haven't bought it yet, no.
Isn't that an oversight?
yeah, I just haven't got around to that yet.
I mean, what if somebody gets there first?
That would be a shame.
Well, somebody has.
Yourself.
I've also bought myeverydaypyjamas.com, myeverydaypyjamas.net, and just to really protect my investment, myeverydaypyjamas.uk. So now, you're essentially looking for £250,000 worth of investment in a website that you don't own.
I'm not being funny, mm-hmm. but this business plan yeah. is not a business plan.
No.
The interview's terminated.
Thanks, Claudia. It was nice to meet you.
Savage.
Oh,
absolutely hideous.
Okay, from the video, thank you. I've been able to follow through the comments on YouTube. Yeah. Sorry about the video breaking. I'm going to share the link later, so I think it should be made available to anyone that needs that. But the major context of the video, which is important, I mean, which was one of the major reasons why I shared it, it's just a pity that it was unable to play fully, like I intended. It's looking at how important it is to plan. So one particular part of the video that most of us would have missed, that was the last part, was where, I'm not sure if it played fully to that extent, but a particular place whereby a lady had a business, and then she was also presenting a business plan to position herself for funding. But at the end of the day, the interviewer or the potential investor had gone online to do a bit of research and found out that as far as the domain name of the business was concerned, for example, let's assume you're looking at the Fortune Cookies, that is the name of your business, a biscuit or a cookie making business. As far as that was concerned, the lady had seemingly done everything. She had a good business, but she missed one important part. If a business was going to go virtual or you needed to have a website, the man went ahead to purchase all the domain names of her website, fortunecookies@yahoo.com, bought everything. So, and then in case of when some of us are not aware, this is quite a common practice. It's just like you're looking for a visa date for an embassy appointment or something. Some people would have gone ahead to even purchase some of those dates and want to resell it to the highest bidder. That could be a common practice as well. So the man had actually gone ahead to purchase all those things. And now she had the business, but he had the domain names. That meant that it's either she decided to buy them back from him or decide to change her business name. So I think one of the important things that the video wants to share or throw more light to us is the importance of planning. Very, very important. So I'm just going to rush through other aspects of the presentation. So we're looking at the fundamentals of proposal writing and grant application. How are they different? Generally, by definition, grant application is the formal request for funding that individuals or organizations submit to grant-making bodies. So when you want to call it grant application, grant applications are different from, let me say, applications for funding or requests for investment. They could be different terms. But when I'm talking specifically about grants, it's you from submitting that request for funding to a grant-making body. And most times, it's not just you waking up to decide to be able to put that out there. There's usually the call for grant applications. So the funding body or the grant-making bodies puts out a form online or, like a template online that, okay, this is 2024. We're starting around in October. You can apply from June to July or to August and the like. So they give you the timelines or the deadlines for some of the things needed. So when you actually see that grant and you feel eligible and you start applying for that grant or submitting application, that's actually what you want to term as grant application. And it comes in various ways. There could be options whereby the grant application could just request, the grant bodies could just request you to send a formal proposal. And some other points, some grant bodies want to design the very, very interactive website that says, okay, for you to apply, you have to fill in these different forms. Recently, we applied for, Elimination of Violence Against Women is such a United Nations-based grant application. And basically, some other grants want you to submit your pitch, they submit all those things one by one. These ones specifically asked for everything in boxes on their websites. That means you are not submitting a full document as it were. You broke all your ideas into different aspects of the box. For example, what is the project location? How much do you need? How many people do you want to get? What kind of consultancy firms are you working with? And all those things. So when it comes to grant application, one major rule of the thumb is to be able to work effectively One major role of the thumb is to be able to work effectively with what the grant-making bodies are asking. It's like you're buying drugs and you need to look at what the manufacturer said. So if you're applying for their specific grants, don't just assume everything is going to be in a blanket format. Secondly, proposal writing, basically, you know, creating a document that outlines a plan or idea. There are different kinds of proposal writing. And while there are many templates out there, sometimes when you're submitting proposals to some firms, to some donors, to some funders and the likes, it's also good to do a bit of research to understand what kind of proposals do they need? What kind of proposals are they watching out for? Some might say it should not be more than a page. Some might say it should be 12 pages. Some might say it should have the team structure. You know, some might have some specific requirements. So, I mean, sometimes you could just go to anybody and tell them to write the proposal for you. While that is a common practice, one important aspect I want all of us to pick from this session is that no matter what you're applying for, your research is very, very important. Find out what the donors or what the people you are requesting or you're submitting a proposal to actually need. Sometimes it's possible that some of us blindly just send, maybe I'm seeking funding, I blindly just get a website, a particular company, maybe Microsoft or Google and the likes. I just send a blind proposal to them. It's not usually the common practice. And that's why it seems some people keep applying for a lot of things and then they don't seem to go through. So there are many processes to go through that. One of it is to even find out who should the proposal get to. Now, I live in grant application, we're looking at generally submitting proposals. Who should the proposal get to? Do they even have a form on their website to place their states if you're submitting proposals to them? The link, I mean, the email you should send it to, what format it should be and the likes. Very important. So sometimes you want to actually reach out to them and, you know, clarify one or two things, confirm where your proposal is supposed to land and ensure that you've done everything needed. And then you actually send it there and work around that. So when it comes to proposals, there are different types of proposals. There are proposals for projects, there are proposals for businesses. So I know some of us have projects on the side. Some of us want to go into education and the like. So we want to have proposals for maybe projects itself, proposals for businesses. Some of us in the sciences or probably in the research area want to also put out research proposals. A bulk of us did this in our university education as well. And then, like I said earlier, there are the aspects of grant proposal. So just to go through time, what are the structures, or I mean, what is the standard structure of a grant proposal? Now, one important thing is all these things will be found online. So I'm not going to waste too much time in doing something. I mean, in saying something that we could actually find on YouTube or any other place. So what I'm just going to give, it will be some tips from my own personal experience. Generally, when you're looking at proposals and the likes, whether it's for grants and the likes, it could be, I mean, you want to have your executive summary that actually covers aspects of your overview, your objectives, your methods, and your expected outcomes. Some grants or some funders or donors would specifically request you to send just your executive summary, and they want the executive summary to just be one page, and it should have everything. It should describe who you are, what you do, your ideal customers or your ideal beneficiaries, depending on whether it's a business or a project. It wants you to talk a bit about the projects you want to do, you know, the potential impact you have to make, the challenges or the questions you want to answer, and then the budget or the ask or what you expect, and then some of the expected outcomes. So, like I said, while it might be prudent enough to have all these things available, one thing is to be able to do your research. And that's why if you look at the right-hand side of this, one of the things I talked about is do your research. That is the first thing. It's not necessary that sometimes somebody could ask what is the ideal size or volume of a grant proposal or a proposal. And I mean, people could say it's 5 pages, 10 pages, 50 pages, 20 pages, and the likes. One important thing is if you're submitting a targeted proposal for a particular project, a particular investor or donor or grant-making body, do your research to understand if they have some clear terms on how they expect their proposals to be like. Very important as well. Then another thing, again, make it clear and concise. I'm still going to talk about this once in the other aspects. Highlight your unique selling points. Now, there's a proposal to maybe clear some of the waste in a particular environment or so in a particular community. That could be a proposal to do one or two or three things. Now, when it comes to your unique selling points, especially if you're working on a project, why? I mean, you're not the only person. Let's assume you want to clear out some of the debris or some of the debts in a particular community. Why should you be the person for that? Why should they consider it for that funding and the likes? One important thing, and I'm sure if most of us can actually have someone to write this down, part of a unique selling point might be what makes you stand out. For example, I could just be an individual that's had it, and I feel I have a calling to make the environment clean and how to do that. You could also be an individual that you've partnered or you've done some of these projects in the past before, especially if it's streamlined to what they exactly need. Another individual could probably be working for a recycling company or even have a waste disposal business. Another individual, you know, there are different points See, it depends on how you want to present yourself. So it's not just enough to say you have the calling or you have the wish or the will or the zeal to solve this problem in the society or not. One thing is, you're not the only person that have that. So what makes you special might be how do you position yourself? Some of the smart ways to be able to position yourself might mean, you know, partnering with other people in that industry. For example, you want to partner with a youth group, for example, that can actually give you volunteers to come out, to come with you to work. You want to mention that already have a partnership with some of those groups. So if you need people to work with you on that project, you already have that. Probably not to partner with a waste disposal agency such that, you know, by the time you guys take the pictures with the waste and the dirt in black or white nylons and the likes, the waste disposal company that I partnered with is coming around to pick up all those things and dispose of them properly. You probably also want to partner with the media. You know, there are different options, but the point is, what your unique selling point is one important thing. Another aspect is too, and it's how do you strengthen your position? You strengthen your position usually based on partnerships. Not all partnerships have to include signing an MOU and the likes, but it's actually important to mention what you've done in the past and also apply some of these things from a position of strength as well. Then, of course, it's important that you include aspects of your budget. People want to know, okay, this is not going to be free work and the likes. What is actually very important? I mean, what are the financial obligations you expect from donors or the potential investors? And the last, I'm using both donors and investors in two angles. Some of us could be using it in forms of businesses. Some of us could also use it in the forms of working on community development projects and the likes. Then another important part is to be able to proofread your proposal. Very important. Next aspect, basic components of proposals. Now, there is no direct rule to this. It could be different. There's no specific one. I mean, there's no specific rule that says, I think I'm having a question here. Is there a difference between grant application and proposal writing? Of course, there's a difference. I said earlier, you could be writing a proposal for a business. I want to open a new shop at Allen Avenue in Lagos, for example. I want to do a research, finding out regenerative effects of Moringa, for example, the science-based research. You're writing a proposal on setting up a community center. A proposal could just be, this is what you want to do, and you're proposing that this is what you want to do, and you're reaching out to people to give you funding. Now, a grant application is specifically seeking or writing a proposal directed to a grant. That means you cannot just write the proposal. You could write a proposal and send it to me to be able to fund the project if you feel I'm one of our ideal donors. But when it comes to grants, a grant-making body should have put out a grant option available online, and then you apply for that grant. If part of the expectations for the grant application informs that you need to submit a proposal for that grant using these specific timelines, then you are now submitting a grant proposal or a grant application proposal specific to that. So the major difference between grant application and proposal writing is proposal writing could be anything. It could be proposal for any project you want to do. But when it comes to grants, a grant making body should have put out a grant either on their website. I'm going to show that later on. There's a grant available, like there's an announcement available, and you're specifically applying for that announcement. And if that announcement says, as you're applying, part of what you need to do is to submit a proposal that is 2 or 3 pages, then you're writing a proposal for that grant application. If they say there's no need to submit a proposal, all you need to do is to log into their website and fill out the form. Let me give an example. It's like you're applying for a job, okay? Some job ads or some job site will tell you to click on this link and fill the form. So you're not submitting your CV, you're not submitting your cover letter to an email, you're actually filling out the form. And every aspect of your CV has to be filled into that form. So if they say you fill that form and then you're looking for that email and sending your CV and your cover letter, nobody's going to answer you. So the company that's hiring you said, okay, that's a job advertisement. That is the grant advertisement, and the grant application advert. And the specific instructions are, for you to apply, click on this link and fill the form. Another one could be for you to apply, send your CV and your cover letter to this. Another, so it's very, very important to understand the differences. Okay, so when it comes to proposal, I'm not going to go too much into this. We are all familiar with some of this. Most proposals want to have a narrative section, you know, talk about the executive narrative. You want to tailor it to what the funder's goals are. Very important as well. Now, another important thing is you want to be able to solve a problem in the community and the society. So you want to identify what the problem statements are. For example, let's say one of the SDGs could be this zero hunger. You want to solve the food hunger. It's almost difficult to assume your single solution could ensure that there is no hunger in the world again. But the point is, major problem is the UN SDG, one of its states, zero hunger. So how do you, I mean, what are the different checklists that can make sure you make food available for everybody? And then how is your own project going to come into play that if your project is sustainable and is sustained or is replicated in different regions or different localities and likes, you can actually push out and we can actually even make a particular step towards that aspect of solving food, I mean, the world hunger and the likes. So, yeah, I mean, I've talked about the executive summary. Another aspect, again, like I said, it should be solution focused. If you have the expertise, for example, if you have a business or you have a waste disposal company yourself, that means to a large extent you're an expert when it comes to solving that problem. So it's very important to be able to touch this aspect as well. You want to be able to talk about the expertise. If you've done it before, even if you don't have a degree in that particular area, for example, if you're submitting for a research proposal, you know, you have your master's, you have a master's, you've done this research course, you've done so, you want to be able to highlight probably in a line or two why you are the best person to be considered for that. If you've done it in the past, if you've even gotten previous funding in the past as well, it's also important to be able to mention some of these when describing your project as well. Then budget aspect, I'm going to talk about that later. Another thing again is timeline. If the proposal is submitting, let's say when you're applying grants, they are telling you that the grant is going to run for a whole year. That is from January this year till December this year. So you want your timeline to be able to fit into what they want. So if they inform the January 2024 to December 2024, and you want to start a project and they expect the project to run throughout the year, that means call for application is ending mid-January. You get selection process and due diligence will be done towards the end of January. Funding will be released early February or mid-February and the likes. So you don't expect to put a project that's going to start in October or November or December. You want designing your implementation framework, you know, how you want to do that for. Are you going into communities to talk to people first? Are you doing a bit of research? Are you speaking to some gatekeepers and the likes and all those other things? I'm sure there are just too many things here that might be difficult to explain most times, but Gantt charts on the screen here is something you want to go into. So they just shoot a specific timeline. December, I mean January, what is going to be done? February, what is going to be done? March and the likes. Anybody that looks at that just understands that, okay, from January to the ending of the year, your project kind of runs through as well. Then in points of evaluation, how do you want to monitor and evaluate the project? We are an SDG-focused group and the likes. So it's very, very important that you want to be sure that the grant said you should do this. You said they're going to do this. So you want to ask yourself, which of these have you done? What are the challenges you have? So monitoring and evaluation aspects should also be available. Sometimes, do you want to evaluate middle of the year and then ending of the year? Do you want to evaluate towards the end of the year? And the likes? It's also important to mention some of these things in your application as well. The indicators for success, you could also want to call that the expected outcomes. For you to be successful, do you want to assume that, for example, let me give you the same example I've using earlier, with disposal. With a particular community and help them ensure that maybe their market square is clean. I want to do that as a one-off activity. That means it's possible that the funders or maybe the M&E staff, even if they are not going to be in-house, they might be external, they go to the market in a select time, probably in June or July, and they check and the market is dirty. But then you inform them that every market is going to be clean and all those other things. So what will success be like for you? Success could be like, you know, probably ensuring that you're putting somebody on ground to make sure that some things are being done well. Another aspect of success could also be like, you know, you're probably even partnering with some of the local people in the community, or, you know, it could mean anything. It could even mean that you're even giving a full-time employment to someone to just make sure that that person solves that particular problem. Very important as well. Then also in the Gantt chart, the timeline and milestones. So it's important. One aspect you need to do as well is to be able to understand your data collection timeline. What sort of data do you need? What is your sampling model and method going to be like? Are you looking at community surveys? Are you looking at speaking to maybe the kings or some of the chiefs in that community? Are you looking at, you know, doing probably a random sampling? Are you looking at probably going online to get your research? These kind of things are key components of a proposal. Now, there's no specific format for how proposals should be presented. That's one thing I just want to let us know. There are lots of formats and generic information out there. But one thing I will keep advising is, if you're submitting a proposal to a funder or a grant-making body, you must do your research to understand if they have a clause on their website or somewhere that states this is how we want our proposals to be like. So people could also tell that they want the proposals they're submitting to have pictures of your previous community work and the likes. You get, I mean, I was looking through the SDSN and the program and outlook for this, and I was able to see that, okay, yes, we had the general, you know, the overview of the project and every other thing, the activities, you had the kind of timeline of the master classes. And another important aspect was that we had picture section on some of the past advocates and some of the projects they've done. So it's possible that, I mean, looking at that picture part, some people could also say, okay, when it comes to submitting stuff like this, we don't want to see the pictures, just send your text. Some people could also say they want it to be picture heavy. That means looking at that, I can say, okay, this group, they've done well, and they've also had proof to show that they've done stuff like this in the past. So it's very important. Another aspect, because of time, I think another aspect I want to go into, we'll be looking at the aspect of budgeting. Now, budgets are very, very important. In the context of grant applications and proposals and the likes, just what you call the ask, the ASK. ASK is basically how much do you need? If the grants application body requests that you should put it in US dollars, for example, or the request is specific currency, it's important that you make sure your budget aligns with that currency. And in the point of your Excel sheet, you want to put an asterisk. What I generally advise people is, for example, let's assume the exchange rate is currently probably 152 naira to a dollar. And by the time you submit your project or when they're reviewing it, it could be next month and it could have changed. So one part you want to do sometimes is put them to actually work with the CBN official rate, although that rate might actually change once in a while. But from common practice, it's advised that you have a clause or an asterisk somewhere close to the ask, especially if it's an Excel sheet, where you put the exchange rate used for that particular budget. And if possible, if the exchange rate is from a website, you want to put the website link and the date. Now, if the current exchange rate from CBN website, for example, is 1,500 naira to a dollar today, and I put that the exchange rate as of today was 1,500, by tomorrow, next month, next week, it could change. So how to protect yourself from this aspect of budgeting is, what is the website you're using for the conversion of the budget? Very important that I actually state this aspect. If possible, and I actually advise, put a link as a hyperlink on that box of the website you use, so somebody can actually check. For example, there could be different websites available. It's so possible that the website I use might be a website that just came up newly. If people don't understand, what website do you use? Sometimes when you use a generic website, people check, and when they find out that it's probably not the official rate for your country or for your currency, it might actually be a red flag. So for example, if it's CBN rate, you want to put the CBN website that you got that rate from, you want to put the date that you got it from and what the figure was like, 1,500, so that anybody that's checking can confirm that, okay, as at the 17th of February this year, CBN website actually showed that this was the rate, and then everything's very correct. So please, it's very important that we actually stick to this as well. So talking about the budget, like I said, okay, this is just generically looking at them. Let's assume you're looking at them. It could be proposal for a study, it could be proposal for business, it could be proposal for research, it could be proposal for anything. Okay, so another thing I also want to talk about is looking at the I don't know. The live chat seems to have ended, so I don't know if it's still going ongoing. Maybe Timothy, I don't know if you're going to check that on YouTube. It seems to have ended, but I'll just continue. So I'm still looking at this as well. Like I said earlier, following the guideline of the funding agency is very important. What this should do with the budget, it's important that you have to work with that as well. Then also categorizing each item, very, very important as well. It's important that all items are categorized effectively, which is where they should fall into. Another aspect is when it comes to value for money, it could depend on a lot of factors. Firstly, if it's a grant-making body or a body that's given out the grants, when it comes to value for money, there might not be, depending, I mean, there are different kinds of grants out there. There are grants for profit businesses, there are grants for community projects, there are grants for not-for-profit. But the point is that they are giving out a sum of money to you. And when it comes to value for money, value could mean a lot of things. For some potential grant-making bodies, value could be in terms of impact per se. For example, you say you're going to reach out to 500 people in a community. That is in terms of impact. So if they give you that $40,000 and you're able to successfully reach out to 700 people, that is actually value for their money, because that's where they're tagging their money. So that's the metrics they're using to measure the money they're giving you. If some people want you to be that, you know, they want you to improve your business metrics, they want you to be able to even plow back profits back to them, they want you to be able to get a percentage or whatever, you want to understand the money that I give you, what does value mean to this body? And ensure that you work around that as well. Then also in the budget, aspect of expenses and revenue. For example, especially if you are in the for-profit space, if you're in the not-for-profit space, you might not really be looking at aspects of revenue. Revenue could actually also come into play. Yeah? Okay, Okay, so revenue could actually come into play in the context of not the revenue for yourself as a facilitator of the project. It could be revenue in the terms of the people that are going to be the potential beneficiaries. For example, if you have a project to do a kind of skill acquisition in terms of, precision agriculture for some farmers in a particular community, assuming that those farmers are not making as much money as they would have made, and then yours is to be able to teach them one or two or three important AI-enabled or tech-enabled skills to ensure they're increasing their productivity. You get revenue could also be in terms of potential revenue for the farmer. Maybe a typical farmer is earning 27,000 naira per month selling maize. Are you able to teach you one or two or three ways of improving on his maize farming or planting and the likes? And so when you move from 27,000 to about 72,000, for example, that's actually another way you can actually key that back in. But this usually comes in when you're giving your impact support as well. Okay, sorry, Janet. I just wanted to mention the live chat seems to have ended on the YouTube page. So I don't know if it's something that can be worked on. Okay, then also tracking expenses is also very important. And then I think it's very, very important to not overestimate your budget. You're not the only person applying for the grant or writing that proposal. So if assuming the market price of one particular, let me say the typical flight fare from Lagos to Abuja, for example, you're living in Lagos and your project is going to be based in Abuja. Let's assume the flight fare for return ticket per person, every all things being equal, is going to be about 170,000. Let me just say 200,000. Let me say 200,000 to be fair. And at the end of the day, you're putting 350,000 for return tickets for just one person by next week or next month. That's actually a huge overestimate, and then most people actually want to be able to flag some of those things. So it's important that you do your research a bit. And next aspect we're going to be looking at is in terms of funding, funders, and the expectations. Generally, when we're looking at funders, we basically have different types. And because of time, I'm just going to rush through this. There are the individual donors. Individual donors could be anybody that is interested in your project. It could be anybody interested in your project or anyone that just feels like, okay, I'm a philanthropist in the society. If you offer this value, I'm willing to fund that as well. Corporation, most individual donors actually do more of the direct donations. The aspects of corporations as well. Corporations could be a foundation, Ford Foundation, the Gates Foundation, and the likes. There could be corporations, big businesses. It could be some of the for-profit businesses that we know. It could be some banks. It could be some oil companies and the likes, especially probably in a marketing department or their program department as well. It could also be private and independent foundations, foundations that are not linked to anybody specifically, just an open foundation that, you know, they just have their terms of board of trustees and the like working, but it's not linked to a particular company, not linked to a particular huge individual per se. There could also be community foundations. Most of these community foundations could be limited geographically. And then there are also government agencies. Most government agencies, whether it's in Nigeria or outside the country, you say it and the likes. Most of them actually offer more of grants and contracts. And when it comes to reach, their potential impact areas are very, very huge and wide. So they want to reach as much people as possible. Then still looking at them, aspects of types of funding. Funding could be generic. There are different types. There are the program-specific funding. There could be a program that says, okay, I want to do ABC in this community, and I'm looking for funding. That's a particular program-specific and defined activity-based funding. And then there could be the aspects of general operational support. It could just be that you have a foundation or you have a group and someone just gives you money, that whatever you guys need for that group. One thing about program-specific funding is if you're asking for $40,000, for example, it has to be directed towards that program. Okay, thank you. It has to be directed towards that program. It's very important that if it's for program-specific options, it has to be directed towards that program itself. Then when it comes to aspects of general operational support, they could actually give you funds to improve your business. They are not probably even telling you about what exactly to do for that funding or for that amount or something. So at the end of the day, you could decide, okay, you want to use the funds to buy a bus, you want to use the funds to hire some staff, you want to use the funds to expand and the likes. Most of these funds usually come in forms of investment to be able to upgrade your business or your foundation and the likes. And then let me just go into the next one. I think we'll talk about this. So looking at funding specifically, looking at funding specifically, let me see if I can zoom in on this a bit. Okay, looking at funding specifically, I hope it's going to be clear a bit. So looking at funding specifically, there are various expectations. One thing is, The same way funders are intentionally choosing grantees, if I'll use that word. So there's the benefactor and the benefactee, if I'll use that word, or there's the person giving out the funding and the person that's receiving it. So the same way the funders choose who they should give funds to, 20 people could apply and they want to select one. Just like the same organization, 20 people apply for a job and they select who they want to work with and who they want to hire. It's the same way also those applying for jobs or those applying for grants should be selective on the kind of funders we are reaching out to. So it's not just any money that comes in from anywhere, you just take it. Some funds could actually even be options of getting a particular part of your business, a particular part of a project, or, you know, probably don't want to say, as far as the promotional materials are concerned, they want to use your loan, they want their logos to be exclusive, and, you know, something. Some might even tell you that if they give you that fund, you are not supposed to collect funding from any other person for the next 6 months or 1 year and all those other things. So please, very important, research is very, very important. You want to be able to research your potential funders or potential people are applying for your grants to confirm some of the things they've done in the past. What are their terms and conditions like? For example, there are like four archetypes looking at this picture. Okay, let me just unzoom it again. So there are four archetypes. There's the left top corner, funders that, I mean, projects that are beneficial to the funder, but not beneficial to the grantee. An example could be a pet project. For example, they have something in mind and they are looking for who to just execute that. When this kind of thing works, it pushes them in the limelight, but it's possible that you might not even get any recognition. Okay. So it's usually funding that is focused on the personal needs of the person doing that. For example, I could be the CEO of a company, and I could just tell my marketing department, I want to celebrate my birthday, and I want to go to Motherless Babies Home and the likes and everything, and it has to be my name everywhere. So pet projects most times are beneficial to some of the funders. Most times they might not be necessarily beneficial to the person giving out the grants. I mean, the person receiving the grants. They are also going to be beneficial to the beneficiaries, the people that are going to be collecting, the people that the fund is going to be executed towards and the likes. Then on the bottom left corner, there are some projects that are not of benefit to the grantee, and then they are not of benefit to the funder. Some of this could be a funder that, the philanthropic goals are not clear. I don't really want to go to this, but then when we probably go to the slide, I'm going to see this. But another aspect might also be aspects that are beneficial to the funder, beneficial to the grantee. Some aspects of this are one of the specific things we want to go into. So that top right corner is something we want to look at. Target funders that their funding or their grants are beneficial to you as a grantee. The person receiving is beneficial to your project, to yourself as well on one point. Obviously, it's going to be beneficial to the funder for them to be putting it out as a grant per se. The benefits could be in terms of probably bringing in more money to them, bringing in more marketing options to their products and the likes, you know, pushing out their CSR projects and the likes as well. And also when it comes to the beneficiaries, it's going to be important that it's quite beneficial to them as well. So from cases like this, the impact will be targeted. Okay. It could be periodic as well. And then there's going to be engagements. So most times the funders want to engage with you often, and even if possible, want to engage with the beneficiaries of their funding and the likes. So because of time, I'm just going to go into, I think I have some more minutes to go, just go into some of the other aspects of research and relationship, which is one of my major aspects of this particular session. So research and relationships when applying for grants and when writing proposals. Very important, six major rules. First off, you want to do your research well, okay? Very important. Another part is to find out a networking strategy that works for you. Most times, while some of us might want to go online only to apply for grants and funding, some other people actually want to go to networking events and speak with, for example, if you are reaching out to Ford Foundation or Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation for funding, and you find out that they are meeting at, Eco Hotel in Lagos for a particular, maybe a fundraising event or an international event and the likes. And yeah, you can register and you're allowed to be there. It's one of the smart things most people do, to go there, probably speak with some of them and say, okay, I found out that this fund is available. I want to apply for it. And when you network well, at the end of the day, you become a bit special in that they can even give you some of the guidelines. Okay, when you apply, tell me about your project, and you're able to pitch your project to the program manager or a member of staff up front. And it seems interesting to them. And they're like, okay, send me the link or, for example, apply online. And when you apply, let me know. So I mean, 50 or 100 people are applying, but then you've actually made yourself a bit special because you attended the event and you spoke to somebody. You've kind of pulled yourself a bit from that particular line. One of the things I do when I'm working with foundations or companies applying for grants is to focus a lot more on networking. If they have a particular event somewhere in Nigeria and I can attend or I can encourage the foundation or the company to attend, send someone there with your ID card or your uniform to attend. And, you know, talk a bit about all those kind of things. Get personal sometimes. And also, when you're applying for your grant, it's important to have a clear ask. What is your ask? You're asking for $40,000 for your project. Sometimes when you're sending out a proposal, you might not need to put everything in the budget. Sometimes the people don't even want you to send the budget up front. Some just want you to give a bit aspect of the of your ask. So just putting out that you need $40,000 for a particular project is not enough. Sometimes you might want to put a pie chart that divides a project into four. For example, let's assume you're putting out a scholarship option. You're kind of putting out scholarship options for children out of school children in a particular community. And you're asking for $40,000 for 2024. An example could have a pie chart or a graph that shows how are you sharing that money, how are you splitting or giving out that money to the different aspects of the project. For example, when it comes to scholarship, tuition is a major aspect. Apart from tuition, there are fees and allowances. Fees could be maybe you want to register for work or you want to register for SSC, write the promotion exams and the like. I mean, put promotion exams and the likes. Another aspect could be in terms of probably, are you looking at covering aspects of their feeding? Are you looking at giving them allowances for transport? Are you looking at covering aspects of their accommodation, aspect of their books and the likes? Another aspect could be like, for example, are you having other forms of support for community support? Do you want to do extra lessons for them? Another aspect could naturally be in the forms of administrative cost or in forms of your M&E. So if you ask for $40,000, don't just assume that when you ask that, I just give to you that. Sometimes they are reviewing 20 or 30 proposals.
I swear, I said this.
Okay, sometimes they are reviewing 20 or 30 proposals. And it's important that you kind of stand out. So how you want to stand out is if they ask, they tell you to maintain the ask, and you ask about $40,000. You want to put probably, even if you can't put a pie chart there, put four bullet points. My project is going to be broken down into tuition on one part, administrative cost on the other part, marketing on one part, and then maybe aspects of something else on the other part. 60% of the funding goes to tuition. How much is that 60% in dollars? You want to put it there. 20% goes to marketing. How much is it? You want to put it there. This one goes to administrative costs. What are the administrative costs? Do you want to put, aspect of that, do you want to put that there? And they cannot put a link that says, okay, this is the link to the budget. So that somebody looks at that and says, okay, this is clearly stated. And then they can actually go in to kind of check aspect of the budget. So just to rush through this, relationship is very, very important. One thing I would advise is if you're applying for a grant or funding, go to LinkedIn, follow their company page or their foundation page, find out who the program officers or the representative of the company in charge of that funding or that grant is, if possible, send them a connection request to get studied them in PT. If they're having one or two or three events, it's not going to be bad if you go to those events and probably speak to them and let them know they're applying for this as well. Then also, when you're applying for grants, you want to do a bit of research. Some of the grants have the past recipients of their grant awards. It's still important to be able to go through the aspect of the website to find out who are the people that won this before in the past. And also, whether I can reach out to them and say, hi, for example, let me give an example. Doing an MLU foundation grant, $5,000 has been in existence, I believe, from 2015. So there are many people that have won it. I want to apply for it this year or next year. They actually have some of those success stories on their website. So it's not bad if you can track some of them down, speak to them and ask, how will I be successful? How did it work for you? And also important that you probably want to work with those recently, the recent recipients, not those way back, because a lot of terms and conditions would have changed per se. If you want to be able to track some of them down, professionally reach out to them to ask for advice. Now, when you look for, when we're talking about searching for your proposal writing and the likes, where do you want to find them? I mean, we're in a digital age, so even if I don't put anything here, sometimes we can actually find that. There are lots of them online. Okay. You could check in with your it could be a government or ministry, a local government. There could be some grants specific to your region or to your state, for example. There are some grants that could be specific to people from Africa or those in Nigeria. Most of the United Nations, UNICEF and the like, development banks, AFDP and the likes might have some grants available. NGOs also have some of their grants available online there. There are online databases as well. You know, education associations, some schools have some grant options available for PhD, master's or even scholarship options available. There are NGOs, embassies of some nations also in Nigeria as well also have some grants available. And the likes, networks, and from looking, so there are lots of options. You just need to go online and go to Google and just put grants for community development, grants for school improvement. You could be grant for anything like a project. I could see quite a lot of them. So if you have access to this slide, I was able to also put some of the top grants, especially for 2024, some of the top grants that are trending. It also show what they are a bit about. You want to do some of the research, be able to explore some of these grants. So on the final slides, I'm looking at time. Aspect I want to talk about as well is, let's assume you've gotten the grant. Now, when it comes to grant, I've said it, want to apply accordingly to what the grant people requested for. If they want to fill a form online and all those things are submitted, you want to do that. And some of these grants kind of give you a bit of space because they want to do all their due diligence and the like. So if they shortlist you for the next stage, most of the time the next stage might not be to probably even pitch or present your project proposal to them. So they streamlined over 7,000 applications down to like 20 or 30 or 40, and then they want to have a pitch deck presentation with everybody. If you want to be able to come online like this on camera, talk about your grant, or sometimes you want to come physically to discuss that. And so, and then for some of the grant giving bodies, that might be enough. For some others, they want to do a bit of due diligence. If you're in the for-profit space, per se, I mean, the last industry I worked in, one of the major things you want to look at as well is who are the people that will manage the money. It's not just enough they're asking for $200,000 and they just give it to you like that because your proposal was sweet to look at or your grant was perfect. If, especially if they're going to be doing a bit of investment or like they're investing in your business or they're buying a particular aspect of your business and the likes, as long as they're giving you that grant, one important aspect is to understand who the people that are going to manage that will be. So that means a part of your pitch deck that talks about your team structure. Do you have, the last speaker talked a bit about governance and the like. So what is your governance structure like? Do you have a board of trustees? Do you have a board of advisors? Do you have, are you the CEO or what role do you play? If they're the CEO, is he the CEO or, are there CFOs and the like? What is the C-suite looking like? I mean, who are the founders of the business? You know, how many are there? Is it like two or three co-founders or two co-founders? What's their relationship like? Are they husband and wife? Are they brothers and sisters? Are they friends? What are their specific skills like? Who are the top managers? Some of them might not even want to know as far back as maybe as far down as, you know, the team leads, the interns, volunteers, and the likes. But this top aspect in terms of governance is very, very important. So when you're talking a bit about if your grant proposal is allowed to be that huge or that much, you want to be able to talk a lot about the team structure because people want to find out who are those that have been managing these funds you are giving to them. One specific impact, extent that you want to look forward to, something you want to boost up is in terms of the governance. Who are the key people that get to be managed? Please, Kito, let me know how many more minutes I have, please. So one aspect you want to look at will be in terms of the governance. In top of the food chain, or on top of the hierarchy, who are those on top? Board of trustees or board of advisors? You want to put them there if available. You want to talk about the founders and the co-founders and the like. You want to talk about the CEOs. And maybe the chief financial officer, chief marketing officer, or some of the consultants to be able to boost, okay, what are the kind of specifications and the likes? You know, most of those things actually help. They want to see the faces sometimes. Sometimes I've been involved in some grant raising, fundraising, whereby we, as all the members of the top management in the foundation, or in the company, have to be at the virtual meeting with the grant giving board, and then they have to review everybody. One was even as detailed as you're talking, for example, you introduce yourself as the chief marketing officer and the likes, they open your LinkedIn or they Google your name to see what comes up. So things like for some of the big based funding and like was part of a huge amount we were looking at raising, stuff like probably your Twitter post, your LinkedIn post, some of your posts, what you look like online is very, very important to them, because if a foundation, a grant giving body aligning to a particular school of thought or something, then it's possible that they want all their beneficiaries to be aligned towards that as well. So all things being equal, you've done the due diligence and everything, and let's assume that you've gotten the grants, you've gotten the funding or some parts of the funding. I've actually started working, on the project. Another thing I also want to mention is that some grants might actually request that you're asking for $40,000 and they give it to you upfront, and then you give them feedback once in a while. Some are just want to give you that money and that is all for them. Some want to give you a part of it. They want to give you, they want to break it down into milestones. Okay, you finish milestone one says you should have developed data of 50 potential beneficiaries. Once you develop that data, you all have a personal or something, and then you send that to them and they cross-check and vetted that it's okay. They want to release the aspect of the fund. Let's say $10,000 for my store one. My store two now says, for example, you're going to go into the communities, start phase one of phase two of the work and everything. When you're done with that, you submit your milestone two documents, they review, they release another $10,000. So that's another aspect. Another aspect of grant or funding could also mean that they're doing a kind of cost sharing. So that means while they're providing 60% of what you need, you're also showing them proof that you can provide 40% of it. It could be 70, it could be 30, it could be 50, it could be 50. It depends on what you guys, what you're agreeing with them. But at different aspects. So that's why I said, it's not just enough to get money from just anybody. You need to be able to do your research to find out who are the funders that are ideal to your business. If you have a business, a foundation, a project that you don't have any funds for, so there's no point in you looking for funders or people that are going to be requesting cost sharing because you don't even have any money to start. It's based on a community development project. And they're like, just like saying, a company wants to build street lights in the community. What is being equal, you might not expect you to allow you for that. So when you're reaching out to potential donors or funders and the likes, you're not looking at cost sharing. looking at someone that is interested in your impact project, the person, you show the person your proposal and pitch the person, and the person gives you that money, you do that, and probably want to put their names, you know, those, this was done by this person and all those other things. So, let's say, I think we've gotten the grant, we've gotten the funding. Why is it that sometimes some people might get grants or get funding, and please, Janet, let me know if I'm going into time, how much time, more time do I have? So, some people might actually get access to the grant or funding, and after this year, it ends in January, it ends in December this year. By next year, you now find out that the donors or the investors or the funders are releasing part B of that funding to the same group or to the same sets. And for some reason, you were not called in or you were not included, they were kind of neglected. What are some of the reasons why some of these things happen? I've known some agencies or some businesses or some people that they offer the same project every year with probably increased or improved impact or increased number of beneficiaries. And every year, they already have a relationship with their grantees, their grant-giving bodies or their funders that for the next 5 or 6 years, they might be signing a contract. As far as this grant is concerned, we're going to be sponsoring for the next 6 years. How do some people see that? How do you get past that phase one, first year, or that first rounding, funding phase aspect, you're going to the next? Some of those things which would inform how you're able to relate with some of the potential donors or the grant-giving bodies. Sometimes some grants might specifically state if you're one of, so they're looking at, for example, the Turn and Money Foundation, you're looking at reaching as much entrepreneurs as possible. So there's a high chance that I don't think you can get some of the specific grants and get them again and again. Just one of you get that and that's all for you. They're looking at, you want to reach 50,000, 100,000, 200,000 people and then increasing the number. So they're looking at individuals that have projects that they can actually bank on. Another aspect could also be, so this is for grant-making bodies that they are kind of specific. They don't want to begin with the same people on and on and on. But if it's a grant-making body or a funder that has a specific market that they want to reach or a specific group of beneficiaries, or they want to work with people that ask, maybe it's part of their CS and they want to work with some specific, just like saying you have a project, and when it comes to your project, logistics is going to be a big part of that logistics. And in that logistics, you want to work with a particular logistics company. That means anything related to your project as far as logistics is concerned, it's going to be that company I'm working with, and they're going to sign an agreement with them. So even if it comes next year, 2 years time, 3 years time, anything in logistics, you want to work with them. So how you're going to be able to, acquire some of this funding and be able to maintain that relationship post the fact that you've gotten the grant or the funding, to even look at the fact that probably next year or next year, you keep getting that grant. One major aspect is going to be, just some of this I'm going to talk about the slides. One first part is actually looking at maintaining line of communication with the funder. Now, let's assume we got funding from Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And then during the funding phase and the likes, your primary go-to person is the head of programs or the head of marketing or one particular individual. Okay, maybe the person in charge of monitoring and evaluation. It's actually good that you have a good, clear relationship with them. Probably, for example, you want to even suggest quarterly meetings or monthly check-in meetings. It could be 20 minutes, it could be 30 minutes, just to give updates. So sometimes when I'm working with grant-giving bodies, I'm working with foundations that are seeking grants, one of the major things I focus on is humanizing who we're working with. They're giving us grants. I want to pinpoint one or two people that we have to relate with. So I have to exchange emails once in a while. I have to reach out to them on LinkedIn once in a while. I also want to be able to have some communication options with them such that not only, even if they give us grants to 20 or 30 companies, somewhere, you know that there's a chance in this company, in this foundation that they can speak with. So that makes you stand out a bit per se. So maintain an open line of communication is important. It could be two phone calls, but it's logically expected or recommended that you use emails once in a while. So sometimes you want to just agree, can we meet on the 27th of every month? By this time, GMT, if you set up a Google meeting pattern that replicates every month. So when it's almost time, people are reminded that if you have this meeting. And why that will put you a bit under pressure, because you want to be able to deliver faster. It improves the relationship. Most times people want to give funding or give money to those they are used to or those that they know. You get. Another aspect also is gratitude also goes a long way. I know they are giving money to executive projects that also make everybody look good. But at the end of the day, appreciation and all those things. So sometimes when you get a fund, and you're allowed to announce it as well. It's also important to also give out that, maybe that social media post. Like I said, some grant-making bodies specifically give instruction that unless they tell you to, don't put out an announcement that says you're officially getting a grant and all those things. So all those things are very important as well. Then sometimes another thing is, for example, if you're going to visit some of the project sites, during the aspect of maybe you're already measuring the results, you're doing your M&E, or you're doing your impact review and the likes, sometimes, if possible, for example, sometimes here you might get some grants from some international agencies, and then if you hear that maybe the program manager is visiting Nigeria for your work on a work visit or something, and let's assume they're going to be based in Lagos, and your project is based in Lagos, it might be prudent most times to actually reach out to them and say, okay, this is the phase of our project. Of course, if you're having a monthly meeting, this is not difficult. And then sometimes they say, okay, when I come to Nigeria or Lagos, I want to come and visit the community, I want to come and visit your project site and the likes. You know, so when they come to your project site, it's a bit different seeing pictures, just like seeing some of the templates that were sent a bit earlier. And I saw some of the schools own a school campaign and the likes, you know, saw pictures. And so imagine if people that give you the phone, they're actually meeting with your school, I mean, meeting with the school or doing one particular project in the school, and you have to invite one or two of the probably potential staff from your funders to be there at that particular event to see some things pass. So, you know, when they see how you deliver on the project and all those things and everything aligns, next time they want to probably renew that project and the like, your name usually comes to mind. So that's why some people seem to be getting the same funding every year and probably for the next 5 or 6 years as well. And another thing again is that when sometimes you're still on the funding or then you're still on the face of the funding, you're done with the funding and you're having that final impact review or that final M&A review, one important thing is also to be proactive to ask, what is the future engagement going to be like? Sometimes when I'm having some projects I'm working with, one of the things I discuss with the funders or the grant awarding bodies be, okay, how is this project ending this year? What is next year going to be like? We've spent a lot of time and resources to be able to develop, maybe encourage 20 market women or encourage APC or do this and this. If next year there's no funding available, how are we going to do it? So, you know, we want to have that kind of discussion to understand what next year is going to be like. Sometimes you might even hear them telling you that, okay, we are still planning on improving this one next year. And then when you find that out, next question you want to ask is, how will I play a role in this? You get, now that we've got the funding for this year, next year, what can we do? And also, it might not even be that project. There might be some sister projects. For example, imagine there's a project that's focused on training students building a computer laboratory, training students on AI and all those other things. And the last, and then they give you a funding to be able to execute that. You finish executing it. What is being equal? They have the computers there, and they have the tabs and the desktops and everything there, and some students are well trained. And that is all. So you might assume that is all. You've got your money, on to the next one. But sometimes when you discuss with some of these funders, they might actually tell you that, okay, they even had the recent meeting, I talked about the fact that, okay, once SS1 and SS2 pass out of the school, GS3 and SS1 will be joining in to get to that computer lab or whatever. Who is going to train them? What's going to happen next? So there might be need for continuous management of the project on one part. There might be need for continuous and maybe improving the reach of the initial beneficiary if you don't reach more students. There must be need, for example, to say, okay, we have the computer labs. How do we train teachers? How do we train maybe school principals? How do we bring in outside? You know, there might be various ways to be able to improve. Okay, 5 more minutes. Okay, thank you. There might be various ways for you to be able to improve on the project and all those other things. So when you have that discussion with the people that are giving the grants, it helps you explore how you can actually play a role. So I think the last part is looking at the impact report. You've gotten the money, you've gotten the grant, you've done everything. Get to come to the end of the project. One important aspect that makes you stand out is how I get to package your impact report. The impact report is usually a brief document that states everything you've done so far. Just give them a journey from the moment you applied for the project, the problem met the community, and how it tailored down to the final result and then the pictures available. Sometimes people want to do impact documentary video before and after this or this community now. Fast forward how many months time, whatever this, you know, before and after the likes. So impact support sometimes naturally comes at the end of a project, but I usually advise that you can do a mini impact or M&A report towards the middle of the project to just show how far you've come. It's more like measuring success per se. And then just another aspect, talk about the data. Another aspect is to use visuals. And then another important aspect is to be able to focus on unexpected outcomes. You said you're going to do ABC. What were the things you met that made it difficult for you to do the C aspect? How did you navigate against that? What were the lessons made? What are the adaptations made per se? These things are very, very important. So it's not to assume that. So, and then when you give this kind of impact support, your lessons learned, your unexpected outcomes and adaptations is going to help the funders or the program itself improve on the next stage. So that if, for example, you say, okay, when it comes to one community in the Northeast or in the Southeast or whatever, they cannot speak English well. So if you're writing materials and some of the materials and focus a lot more on English and you're looking at, okay, can we include a radio option to be able to teach these people and the likes? And for example, that's what we did. So it's important to be able to list some of these things that would have probably damaged some aspects of your project or we're able to work around that. So it's not just enough to say, these are the challenges or these are the problems and hang it on that table. No, these are the problems you met or the problems you met during the course of the project or the program and the likes. This way, how you navigated against that. These are some of the things you learned. And these are some of the recommendations you want to give. So putting it into a kind of helps. And also, this last slide just looks at a generic part of, so some impact reports could be text-based, it could be heavy on text. Some could also be heavy in pictures. Some could also have an impact report video and the likes. But one important aspect is to focus it like we're on the SDG group, focus it on some of the SDGs you're attending to, and also focus on the specific impacts you've made so far. One of the best ways to push this is to put visuals. You can have a text of 10 or 15 or 20 pages that might take quite a length of time to read. You could also have videos, pictures as well. But one important part is when you have visuals that have some of these things in forms of numbers, in forms of percentages, forms of pie charts, bar charts, some pictures, and the like. So these are just some examples. The one at the bottom right corner is from Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. That has a very, very huge outlook. The one at the top right corner, I think it's the most recent fact sheet from the, okay, no, this one, yeah. Okay, yeah, this most recent fact sheet from the Tony Melu Foundation. I think the other one is focused on a mother and child kind of program. So you can see, just looking at this alone, this can just give you a proof of idea. For example, 216 moms were served, 490 children were served, you know, total numbers, you know, some of the metrics and the like. So this is usually what you want to call an impact report summary or an executive summary of an impact report. Usually want to call one page or fact sheet that shows everything you've done so far. So this, in fact, if you're in the social media phase, these are the kind of things you want to put out on social media. You might not want to put out the whole impact report per se, but when you put out these kind of numbers out there, lots of partners are going to be interested in working with you, so that even if you don't get that funding in the future as well, people are going to be working with you. So finally, when it comes to writing your funding application or your proposals, please start early. If they sell the application to start on the 21st of June and to end in March, 20th of March, don't want to wait till the 15th of March to start, because you find out that some documents are not even available. But say, don't leave it to the last minute. Focus on how you use the money you're applying for. Like I've said, they said, don't just ask for the $40,000. How do you want to split that into different aspects and make sure it's airtight? That's where your budget comes in. Also, I know most of us are using ChatGPT and the like. Sometimes when you charge GPT, I don't edit. It's easier for people to find out the buzzwords and the likes of ChatGPT as well. And then also check your applications. When you're done with that, it's not just enough. You want to have a member of your team or a consultant or somebody else, you or somebody outside that's a part of the process, also help you review the application to make sure that it's okay. And then if you are stuck somewhere, finally, if you are stuck somewhere, reach out to the funders. Some funders even have some Q&A or FAQ sections and not to review the funding, to just clarify some things, to reach out to them to be able to clarify other aspects of the funding that you need. So I hope that we've been able to touch a lot more on the topic. And thanks very much, everyone. Thank you. Over to you, Janet.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Charles. We really appreciate that. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in extending our heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Charles by sending in your virtual round of applause for that invaluable session on grant writing. Thank you for sharing your insights and your expertise, which are the key to us with the essential knowledge and skills that are instrumental for us as we secure funding for our impactful projects and initiatives. We are immensely grateful for your time and your dedication and commitment. So on behalf of the leadership of the FPS in Nigeria, we want to say a very big thank you. On this note, I'll be standing in sharing the microphone with Mr. Emmanuel, the coordinator of SDGs Advocate, for to round up and to give us the information that is necessary for us to know about. Mr. Emmanuel, please, you can take over.
Okay, thank you very much, Janet and Dr. Charles. Thank you for the amazing presentation, and to our first facilitator who also handled the session on leadership. Thank you, everyone, and to each and every advocate on the call. We believe that it's been a valuable session indeed, and you've indeed had a very, very insightful learning today. Just to briefly share some information regarding the next phase of this program, because we've seen that there are a lot of concern, there are a lot of comments in the Ask Me form, there are a lot of comments, even in the comment session. And we also observed that some of you are creating WhatsApp pages. This is not allowed. This is not allowed. And if you can remember, during the onboarding session, one of the rules and regulation is we are not going to be having a WhatsApp group for any state for now till we complete the program. So if you are doing that, just know that you are doing something that is very wrong. And we want, basically, the focus is you should definitely work on the masterclass session, build more focus on the masterclass session, get to learn for each and every session. And I know that the program team are also doing everything possible for you to have a very adequate and adequate resources, learning resources beyond the presentation slide. And this is one of the reasons why they have not shared it to you. I'm very sure that when they share it to you, you are going to have more than enough documents which you are expecting. So which covers various areas of SDGs and various areas are in line to what the modules which you've enrolled on this course are. So just look forward to that. And also to say this, which is very, very important, the tracking and evaluation form. For some of us, we've been filling the tracking and evaluation form very wrongly. And I think I should just share screen in a second, and you can see where I'm saying. I think I am able to view some of the submissions recently for last 2 years. And it's so surprising some youths are still doing this. This is a your name. You can see some people writing their names. Some people are saying yes, some are saying okay, some are saying Facebook, some are saying Barack. I can see this person writing his name. I can see okay, but you can see people that are having LinkedIn, Facebook. You are meant to upload your tags on is either LinkedIn or Facebook. That was the instruction that was given to you. And it's very, very paramount for each and every one of you to follow through these instructions that has been laid down. And we won't want a situation whereby you are not, because even when we onboarded people for this quad 5, we still had some people that did not find it difficult to upload their indemnity form. And due to that, they got disqualified, even though they were selected initially. So please try as much as possible to follow the instructions that were being given to you. The link for the tax for the week is also going to be shared with you over the weekend, and you are to carry that out within the time frame. And yeah, very, very, very important. Another area which I'm to address this morning is regarding the next phase of this program, as we have some key things which we are going to be working on in the next phase of this program. I'm going to do that sharing my screen again, and I'll make this very brief and also detailed. And if you have questions, you can get to ask your question. You all have this document. However, sometimes there might be a little changes regarding it, and you saw what app transpired over the last 1 week, and due to the network issues, considering most advocates, actually, we know that we can process the assessment from our hand and you run, but many people will still complain that, oh, I had network issues, I had this and that. So that's more reason why we are having just one assessment for this quad. And please, you mustn't miss the assessment for any reason, because it's one of the major criteria for you proceeding to phase 2 of this program, and also coupled with your submissions in the tracking and evaluation form, on the tracking and evaluation form. So at least you must have a minimum of 2 to 3 entries, at least 2 to 3 engagements through that tracking and evaluation form, which the program managers are going to check through. So very, very important. And we know that towards the end of this month, I know that some schools are beginning to close the session. Some are going on vacation next weekend, while some might be early next week or mid next week. But still very, very important for you to submit the name of the school. This you are doing virtually. We've said that you don't need to go to any school to maybe to take consent to submit their name, or just get a school first within your environment, which you know that this school, I can carry out my own school project. And what you are doing,
actually might have to be a continuation of the Own a School project, because we have a lot of schools, primary and secondary schools, that have been covered in Nigeria, and we are not going to leave the students alone. We keep sensitizing them, we keep educating them towards achieving, like we saw in that first video, the younger generation has more, in the first masterclass session under leadership, the younger generation has more, we have more role to play when it comes to achieving the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. So very, very important for each and every one of us, ensure you submit the name of the school you want to carry out your own school projects. One of the major reasons why the school will be disapproved for you is if another advocate submit the school before you did. So we are advising you to ensure that you submit the name of your school ahead of time so that another advocate will not select. The program managers will definitely track it, and they will see the time which each and everyone submitted the name of their own school project. And when the schools are back to resumption, you can definitely start activities of your own school projects. And each and everyone that their own school projects proposal has been approved will receive an introduction letter from the organization, which you are going to present to the school management. That introduces the project which you are going to be carrying out. And also, you're also going to be given access to a training and learning toolkit for students, which you can use to engage the students on SDGs. So they're also going to share you a drive, which you can see different resources. And maybe if the school has a projector, there are videos you can play for them, for the students, that can even aid your teaching activities or that engagement in the school. And I know some people always ask questions that, are we to teach them the 17 SDGs, or are we to teach them all what we've been taught during the masterclass session? Basically, you are going there to sensitize them, make them know about the SDGs, make them know their role in achieving the SDGs. And you can definitely buy on one SDG. Maybe you are someone that advocates more for SDG 13, and you can get to engage them on activities of climate action. Or maybe you are someone that boils down on clean water and sanitation. So things which they can do. And like we said, we have a lot of schools that they have their SDGs club, and these are things which you are also going to be engaging on. And your visitation is either a one-time or two-time visit. If you want to do it, make it a two-time visit, yeah, that's fine. But it's been expected that it's a one-time visit. And when you are visiting the school, it's very important you take your pictures, because these are evidence. You do your videos, these are evidence that you did this project. And it's not just an evidence that you did a project, it's also an impact story for you this year. We've seen a lot of people sharing this impact story, and it also gets to add to their profile in so many ways, and whereby people are, it adds value. I mean, when it comes to the place of value, there is more to that. And the virtual advocacy, it's also there. This we are also going to communicate with you. But most importantly, what we are communicating with you, which you need to get done right now, is to submit the name of schools which you want to carry out your own school projects. And remember, the assessment is next week Saturday, 10 a.m. on Saturday. I don't know if there is any other thing. And like we earlier mentioned, the tracking and evaluation form is going to be shared with you via email, and you can check your email. You're also going to receive more learning resources on SDGs. If there are questions, you can use the comment section to ask your question. I will try as much as possible to check it out and respond to your questions. I don't know if there are questions. I want to be sure if there are questions from each and everyone regarding what are the information that has been shared with us so far. So, and like I said, each and every of us are going to receive an introduction letter, which we can present to the school management once they resume back. And someone is asking, how do we submit the name of the school? I believe you received, in the last email communication, you should receive a link whereby you can submit of the school you want to carry out your own school project. So, and yeah, if the you can also change the school depending on the situation there, but we believe that it's going to be a positive one. And assessment, so okay, I can see a question from Robert regarding assessment. So it's going to be based on what you've been taught from the beginning, inception of the program, right from the information session to the very last session. And the assessment is going to be virtual. The assessment is going to be virtual, and you are going to receive the link. Yes. Well, regarding the assessment, is definitely something that is quite very simple, and it's just a knowledge evaluation, and it's very important just for you to track and know if at all you've been able to, you understood or you had a very good information about the SDGs. And like I said, it cuts across the entire phases, the entire modules which you are going to have, which you've been trained on. And so regarding the virtual advocacy, we are going to provide more information regarding virtual advocacy next week, which will be the last session, because there are some information that are also going to be shared with us ahead of the next, the last session, which is the last masterclass session next week, Friday. So they are going to share some information regarding virtual advocacy. And I can see some questions. I just want to respond to questions regarding assessment on a school project. Okay, Mr. Bao, I submitted my form. Listen again, he gave me the details of the student and what is going on in school really. Oh, you mean you are submitting the names of two schools? Okay. But in such a situation whereby the second school you are applying to has been selected by another advocate, that school is going to be disapproved for you. Then you have to work with the first school you selected. And the school you are working with can be a primary or secondary school. It can be a private or public schools. I know that sometimes people always ask, let me say this, people always say that public schools are quite difficult to access, and most people also prefer to use public school because they know that there is a real impact to And most importantly, your presentation is you are introduced. And this is meant to be an individual project. Okay. For us that did, okay. I can see someone, I think these are part of the returning advocates. So for this court, there is no state community project. So there is no state community project. All what we are having for phase two is just the only school project and the other virtual advocacy, which you are going to receive more information. They've not sent letters of own schools to you. It's when the school you are working with, you intend working with, has been approved for you. That's when you are going to receive the name of the school. You are going to receive your introduction letter. And I believe all questions have been answered. If there are other information which are very germane and important, you are going to receive it via email. And just like I earlier said, please ensure you take track of all, keep track of all these dates. And very, very important, you carry out the necessary activity ahead of time. wish you a wonderful and productive weekend. Ensure you carry out your tasks still remains the same, and you getting to engage and also share what your learnings have been on today's training session. I know you will have learned a lot. It's been an amazing session. So yeah, just get to engage and you submit the link latest by tomorrow evening. Enjoy the rest of your week, everyone.